then that will, in terms of the actual sessions that we're going to be having, they're going to be, many of the sessions will be of course this term, and some of the other tutors, and then I think we've got a lot of group spring term, and then we're going to be also working with Dan Peterson on the professional practice actual pleasure bearing component of your exposure. So we're going to talk through that a little bit. But to begin with, and while we're waiting for maybe a few other people to arrive, cast your minds back. I posed this question to you last year. Things might have changed and evolved since then. You might have been doing some research and thinking more seriously about where you're going with your work. In terms of making money for what you do, that's one of the things that we consider, not the only thing that we consider in professional practice, but one of the things that we consider. So turn to your partner or turn to in small groups and just have a little bit of a chat.
Last night I was doing a lamp.
That
would be the ideal paint project,
isn't it? I don't know. Mine would probably be like t-shirt design.
Okay.
It's like, you just draw a design, like you get a brief on what it's like, you draw it up and then you send it to them and they print it.
Yeah,
you
so like...
paid. Simple.
Yeah,
it's fun. I need to talk to the textiles studio. You've been saying you want to do t-shirts.
You could like screen print.
Yeah. But like... Last year, like I got like all my like t-shirt designs and all that shit ready, and like all the money, well half the money would go to like charities that have like mental health and all that shit. And they're like, oh, why are you trying to be commercial for?
Sorry.
I'm just trying to make money, Jesus. But like, I don't know. Maybe that's they were waiting for me to do it this year, not last year.
I don't know. That sounds good to me. Like.
But yeah.
Yeah,
it's like, why are you trying to do an illustration studio? Like, it's like what's that question asked right there?
Why are you discriminating?
Yeah, I know. It's just, she just hates me. Why are you even here, Chris? Go home.
I kind of wish I was on product design.
Yeah.
I think I'd prefer that. Or 3D Maker.
It's more straightforward, like graphics, they just get a brief, they do the project, and then that's it. Like,
a lot of hard work.
Yeah.
Yeah, the graphics. When you hand in something for graphics, it has to be perfect. Whereas illustration, you could do it on the front here,
yeah.
And then like, oh my god, that's the best work you've done.
You could scribble something on a napkin and then be like, yes!
It's like, that has so much character. Like, you could do it for 3 weeks, you're like, I'm well out for that.
I wanted to show that people wipe their mouths with art.
I don't know. Like the project that I spent the least amount of time was the best project they liked. And that medication thing, the collection, the little zine, they fucking loved it. I was like handing it around and Chris was loving it. It's like, oh my god. I was like, oh my god, this took me like an hour. Like, wow.
I don't think they've loved any of my projects.
So what are some of your ideas?
I want to get the tattoo of friendship.
Okay. Right. Okay. And so it's interesting to think about this because we're talking about, you know, a single ideal paid project, something specific that you might do. The reality is, like we talked about last year, is that actually a lot of illustrators tend to do a lot of different things. There's a whole range of different activities you could do within the kind of realms of illustration, but also beyond that, lots of illustrators do other things as well as being illustrators. So it's kind of kind of interesting to maybe we'll touch on some of those things today. Who else? Lizzie.
I suppose, like, ideally, what, like, commission work either speaks to you in some kind of way, just like on some kind of issue or, you know, a charity piece. Mm-hmm. It's something you can really get your teeth into.
Yeah. So would that be a project that would be over a long period of time? Would your ideal project be something that you do in a week or something that you spend a year working on? Or?
Probably something you spend a year working on, but in like different parts. Like you'd say, if you're doing charity work, you work the campaign for like a couple of years, but produce a lot of work within that.
Right, okay. Joel, how about you?
I tend to just do lots of different things all the time, so I'd probably prefer shorter briefs that just let me explore different things all the time. But I don't know.
Do you have a sort of just a fantasy, outlandish, something that you just think, oh my god, I would so love to do that, and if somebody could actually pay me to do that, that would be amazing. I'll do it for free anyway, but if someone could pay me, that would be beyond my wildest dreams.
I'd like to do stuff with musicians, so maybe any art they need, whether that's album stuff or even music video stuff. I think I could get in photography and film, but that's about it really.
Anyone else want to share their ideas? Yeah. Have
you got a specific, like a name? I want to put my biggest blast for a piece of work for that person, that company, but with that person. That's what I'm doing.
The Modern Fox?
Yeah.
Modern Fox?
Modern Tox?
Okay.
Comedy. So within how long do you want to get commission from their company?
I don't think so. Let me just do an editorial.
Your ambition is to do it within how long? How long are you giving yourself? 5 years? 3 years? 1 year? Wow, that's a good time. Okay, so within a year, I'm going to have a commission, or my work's going to be in it.
Maybe 3 years.
3 years.
How about you, Elliot? What would you like to do with Ben?
I don't know, I feel like if I got a job with Modern Toss, I'd just be like making the tea, doing the role, you know.
And what would you ideally like to be doing?
I don't really mind. I'd be really interested just to see how they like compile all their books and like do the printing and stuff like that. Or come up with my own like content, but you know, maybe I have to spend a couple of years there. But.
Yeah, and it does help to be this specific. Of course, many of you aren't yet at a stage where you know you have got that level of detail in it. But what we're going to hope to do this year is work towards that, because the year's going to culminate in you making a graduate action plan, and also in you doing a live application. So that might be, for example, you two already know who you would like to approach. And then the whole purpose of the professional development and the professional practice module is to prepare you so that you can make the best application that you can. And also to understand the context of that and how you're approaching that and why you're approaching it in that particular way, what you need to bring to the table when you approach those people. So we'll talk a little bit in more detail about that in a moment.
So I think that, because it gives you an image, the Modern Toss, we know what that is, but it's placed in a cultural context. It's got outputs. And you could say, I want to find that, I want to go inside it, I want to find out how they do it. So I want to do that for something else. I want to do what Modern Toss have done for that area. I want to do a Modern Toss with music. I want to do this. So that's a bigger ambition. So you go in, of course, there's a pressure to go in, and you want to find out everything. The guy who invented the Armitage Shanks, the word crap, Thomas Cooper invented the system. And there were these two young inventors, and they wanted to find out what the officers were doing. People could cut their patents very tightly. So they went in and worked with this other company, pretending to be really, really slow on the uptake. Can you explain it? How's it go again? What am I supposed to do? They went in on this sort of low-level job. And then for a year, they faked being really done, asked loads and loads and loads and loads of questions, and then nicked the whole thing. Still, they went undercover. So you can have also that kind of ambition, getting in somewhere, behaving like everybody else. This is quite like join the police force and you behave like a police person, and then you fight, you do what they subvert that. And so at Manchester, they joined, they were the left wing, they joined the Conservative, the Student Conservative Society, became one of their leaders, and just before the election, they blew the whistle, dished the dirt, just revealed what the Tories had been up to. It's really good. I'm not recommending this, I'm just saying that there are
these
parts.
Well,
I'm doing what I am doing at the moment is one day jobs now, because I've freed up some time, I've been part time. So I've freed up some time to make work from which to teach, so I don't sort of recirculate my own air, so I'm making things up about the real world, which you tend to do after a while. But I've already been a newspaper seller for a day. On Friday I'm listening to some gardening for somebody. It's an artistic conversation, but I'm doing my gardening with somebody else in that conversation. So you can do lots of small jobs as well, as ways in, just for a day. Garden for a day, parkkeeper for a day. Some of them paid, some of them unpaid, but usually, hopefully, some kind of exchange. So in exchange for doing this garden, in conversation with somebody else, we're talking to a leading artist and thinker. So that's a philosophical gardening day. The gardening gets done. Okay, that's an interesting conversation. Then you can do the same thing as the parking attendant. Putting pints. There was a woman in supermarkets in France. She worked for Superu, the big chain, the Tesco's, and she wrote a novel about that, and that's a big bestseller. So there are ways in which those everyday jobs that you do, the part-time jobs, can be actually researched. They can become residences. So that's another way. There are lots and lots and lots, lots of ways in. To allay that anxiety, I suppose what I'd like to do is allay the anxiety that I've got to go after this amazing, there's got to be this job. It doesn't happen like that. It's better than 3 months. Liz, you're talking about a year. I mean, that's long. It's like a £50 note. When I was freelance, it was between one day and 6 months. That's the animation. 6 months was the longest gig. So all you do is you go from one gig to the next, and you do a fantastic job, you exceed the client's expectations, and they recommend you. The hard of it is getting hard retired, because you say you do a fantastic job, they ask you back. You recommend to other people, they ask you back. So all you've got to really be concerned about, I would say, is the first. Just do one thing, and that starts to build. It's a constructing an amazing job at this point. Really interested, being really helpful, being really inquisitive. I'm not worried about your big art. But we're going to look at the big art.
Yeah, and we're going to look at, you know, a lot of what we're going to be talking about is freelance work, because most illustration happens within a freelance context. But some of you might know already that you absolutely don't want to it doesn't suit your personality, and you really want a job with a salary and regular hours. How many of you feel that way? Okay. So then, for you, this, you know, replace project with job, and think about where you might like to be heading with that. And then, you know, it's a different conversation. But what's important is that you start to think about these things. You don't have to make any decisions, nothing's set in stone. Very few people know at your stage exactly what they're going to be doing down the line, or if they think they know, it often changes and they end up going in a different direction. So don't worry too much about having to pin it down. But having a kind of vague sense of what appeals to you is really helpful, because you bring that to us. You know, we're going to have these sessions throughout the year, workshops and seminars and talks, but what's sometimes the most crucial is those individual conversations that you have with your personal tutors. Or, you know, you can know other people in the school you can talk to, or just tutors generally. But you come with particular things, particular directions that you want to go in, and you tell us what those are, and we can help to support you in the appropriate ways for that. You know, it's very different writing a job application than it is putting a portfolio together and getting some promotional material to send off to clients for possible commissions. Do you know
able to tell me. So it's about thinking about what's going to be most helpful for you. So when you write your graduate action plan, it's up to you. You know, it could be going off to freelance work. It could be thinking, actually, I want to go into teaching, and how can I prepare for that? What's my plan for that? It might be that you want to go into postgraduate study. It might be all sorts of different things. But at least you've got something. I think what's helpful is when you do graduate, you've got something solid and concrete that you can do. You've got a plan. You know that, you know, in that kind of twilight zone that sort of tends to happen after you graduate and you just feel a bit lost because you've been in full-time, a lot of you have been in full-time education all your lives. You're used to the structure, you're used to the academic year, you know, your life fitting into that kind of pattern of the academic year. All of that, you're used to being surrounded by people and tutors and teachers, and then suddenly it's different. And that is a big, big adjustment period. And sometimes, and it's really exciting and it's exhilarating and it's free and you know, the world's your oyster, and it's also quite unnerving sometimes. But if you've got something solid, something structured, something you can feel a bit confident about, you know, okay, well, this is what I'm going to do. I've got my list of people I want to approach, and I know how to approach. I know what kind of letters I need to write. I know what kind of work I need to get together, and you've got a plan. That's going to help you feel confident going through that transition period. So that's sort of what this whole, the purpose of this part of the third year is about.
So if you've got an image of what you want to do, so there we are, I want to be happy. Tattoo of the bishop. There it is, that's the vision. So it's having an image of it. That image can change. It's not saying I plan to be I plan to be a senior lecturer by 2055. You can't plan those things. But what I think you need to be is absolutely ready. Almost ready. And open and resourced. So it's about, what I will work on you with you is checking your resources, your resource, what are your skills, being able to articulate to other people and prove it. Because the stuff that's going to swing it in terms of opportunities, it's going to be your qualities and attributes, the softer stuff, but you need to have hard things proof that that's the case, and that might be in the form of testimonials. So if you do a live project this year, just making sure that the people involved who said wonderful things about what you did, you get that in writing. So there are strategies around and making sure that you've got the things that you need so that whoever you're talking to, you can send them something immediately. You can say, are you ready? If I said, take me to your work now, reach for your work now, how quickly can you get to my latest work? Now, mobile phones might be useful, aren't they? But you should have something about your person, I would say, once you graduate. You can always show something to somebody. Very often, somebody says, oh, that's a great project, yes, I made that. And you did last week, and there's a story there. So people carry stuff with them. It's always carrying an invitation with you, or an offer. Yeah, so. And also, what we're going to do is to work with you on being coaches and support for each other and resource for each other. One of the hardest things people find often is talking about their own work or talking themselves up. No problem with this, but other people do have a problem talking themselves up. And it's better though, if somebody says, it was really good, it was great to work with Jack to get referred by somebody else, is much, much better than you saying, you know, I'm brilliant. Because whenever you push forward, there's an even opposite reaction going on, a bit pushy. But if somebody else is saying, you're great, you're useful, then that's proof, it's testimonial recommendation. So what we're going to do when we get to the degree show is that you're going to, when you're people around, of course, not your friends and family, but there are also people who maybe absorb you there and then work. We've had that every year. People come in to the degree show, and they've got opportunities to talk there and then. Being ready for that. But half the time spent talking about each other, deflecting, and talking about other people's work. Well, I wouldn't do that, but you must come and see Jason's work over here. It's really interesting. That means you're interested in other people. It shows that you're interested in other people. Becoming good at talking other people's work up persuasively and sympathetically gives you a vocabulary to talk naturally without feeling like about your own stuff. So it's getting a vocabulary, developing vocabulary, and also physical things, resources. You've got a metaphorical bag of tools and resources and skills. it's being ready. So we'll start off by mapping the things that you've got, the resources you've got, the people that you know, the people that you need to get to know, the conversations you've had, the live projects you've had. So we'll realise what you've already got. You've got loads. And then we'll start making a map, a little bit of a strategic map, which feeds into the planning journey. So that towards the end of the arc of the year, I'll be working on you, with you, upon working with you to find out, to help you find out what is the offer of your work. And you may not be able to see that completely, as other people will be able to see quite a lot of that. So we'll do a lot of discussion and helping each other and talking each other up and noticing the good things that each of us does. So you build a fantastic, amazing support network. What talent, what diversity of expertise here. Because you might be going as pairs and as groups to people with projects, larger projects. So write business, learn to write bids and learn to write applications. Really useful, that's an actual skill that will be very useful. And language you need to use before you making different kinds of formal applications for bigger funds.
So, you know, if you kind of break it down, it's about knowing what opportunities you're looking for, being open-minded, but also kind of having a sense of direction, knowing how to look for opportunities, how to access opportunities, where to look, where do you even begin to find out. And when you do find an opportunity, or when an opportunity comes your way, like Chris says, it is the conversation that you happen to have at a party, and then it leads to something, and someone says, oh yeah, my auntie works for so, you know, often it is actually those kind of coincidental things that lead to work. Sometimes it's, you know, going through the usual routes and contacting people, you know, mail shops and that sort of thing. But you need, either way, you need to be ready. So you need to be ready for the opportunity when it comes or when you find it. And being ready for the opportunity encompasses a whole load of things. For example, having a good website, a good web presence. So that's one of the things that you're going to be doing this year as well. How many of you already have a web domain? Okay. How many of you on that web domain have actually already started putting work and getting a website together? Okay. How many of you don't have one yet but would like to get going with that? Good. And how many of you feel that you need a bit of technical help to get started with that? Okay, good. So you know who to talk to about that, don't you? So just pop upstairs to Graphics, have a chat to him, and he can give you some advice on that. But it might be good to talk to other illustrators about, you know, different kind of options. You know, what kind of website, also just doing your research, what kind of website do you want to have? What's appropriate for your work? Okay, so just to give you an idea of the shape of the year, I'm actually just going to go to Moodle for a second. So this is on the main illustration page. So this is not on your level 6 page, it's on, you know, the overall illustration page. Go to that. And then there's a section down here called professional development. So I've put some resources on here. So it was just a few things I'm starting to put up, like things that I'm finding, like Creative CV Guide, Roots into Teaching Guide, so a few videos I found, some kind of journals and publications related to illustration that, you know, are worth reading. There's also lots more in the library. But just give you, you know, illustrators talking about their experience of work, art directors talking about the experience of commissioning illustration. It's just to help give you a bit of a sense of context. So I'm putting a few things on there. I've also put together this little book, which has got like general resources. It's worth going through these things just to find out what resources the university offers. You know, the university's got things like Careers Hub. They've got the Centre for Entrepreneurship. They're really worth investigating. Just go and chat to them. You know, those people, there was a thing in the heart space yesterday, I don't know if everybody went, but there were people there really trying to get students from the art school involved in thinking about setting up a business and entrepreneurship generally. They're really, really keen to talk to you. So if you go along, there'll be lots of people there who are welcome you with open arms and try and find out how they can help you. So do try to make use of some of those resources. So
you know, this is a work in progress, but, you know, some of the things that we talked about last year, common pathways for freelance illustration. Illustrators go on to do many, many, many different things. You know, what you are developing on the course, of course there's the subject specific skills that you're developing, you know, your particularity as an illustrator, the particular way that you're able to put words and images together, the particular way that you think, the particular mastery you have over certain techniques or materials. But beyond that, it's really important that you start to reflect on all of those other broader skills that you know that you're developing on this course. You know, the ability, critical thinking skills, you know, the ability to give each other feedback. We were talking about yesterday about, you know, there's many, many kind of career paths where, for example, you might need to feedback to people. If you're an art director, if you're a creative director, whether it's in film or, you know, within a publication, like working for a company like that, you might be commissioning other people's work, you might be mentoring people, you might be in teaching, you might be in creative facilitation, you know, doing workshops with other people. There's lots of, many, many situations where you would be required to give people constructive feedback. And that is a skill that you all have, because that's what you've been doing, you know, for more than 2 years now. So start to think, start to reflect. I mean, we can tell you, we know what the transferable skills are that we hope to develop, you know, all of those creative skills and social skills that you're developing on the course. But it's really important for you to just take a step back and you think about it. Think about beyond, you know, the actual work that you're making. What else are you learning how to do? What else can you bring to, you know, a range of different professional situations? Because it's important, as Chris is saying, to be able to articulate that to potential employers or commissioners. Yes, you do this, you've got your portfolio work, but, you know, you take these things for granted, but other people don't. You know, project management, teamwork, all of you have done that. You know, these are things that actually not many, many people come out of their degree without those kind of skills. But because of the unique programme that you've been through, you know, especially including field, where you have had to work collaboratively, and you, every project that you do, you're managing your own time, it's project management. Those are skills that actually are specialisms within art and design and within this school that you have, and that are something that people are really looking for. So for you to have that confidence, to be able to see that for yourself and to be able to articulate it to others, is really going to help you as you go along. So thinking about these, you know, so there's all these different directions that you can take, but some of the typical paths are, you know, working to commission, so that's freelance illustration, which is commissioned. Freelance illustration, which involves making some kind of product to sell. Now that could be self-publishing a book, like Georgina. You're going to be working with Georgina a bit this year. And she's got a shop in Bristol, and she makes beautiful prints and books, and she sells them in her shop.
And she teaches.
And she does commissioned work, and she does residencies. You know, like most illustrators, she does a range of different things. But many illustrators, you know, have shops and they sell products. I know some of you are interested in that. But it's important to see that within a spectrum of practice. You know, other freelance creative jobs, so there's freelance illustration, but there's other creative jobs that you can do as a freelancer. So there's many, many different things that you can do as a freelancer. You could be a freelance creative director, you could be, you know, a freelance prop designer, you could be a freelance workshop provider for museums. So there's all sorts of different creative freelance work. Public engagement and teaching. You know, going through a formal teaching path, like through a PGCE or something like that, is one option, but there's also freelance ways that you can do that too. You know, last year I think we talked about people like Sophie Herzheimer and Lindy Allback. Remember those people? And, you know, a lot of the work that Chris does. You know, publishing, the whole world of publishing, children's book, you know, it's very, very different. You know, magazines are within the world of publishing, children's books are within the world of publishing. It's a completely different approach to work. You know, a magazine, getting something published in a magazine, like Chris was saying, might just be a few weeks turnaround. A children's book might be a 5-year project where you're you know, not paid very much for 5 years, but you're working with a publisher. You're probably doing lots of other things at the same time, but it's a long-term effort. And it's, you know, so the whole kind of way that you go about something like that is very different. You know, obviously there's different, it depends on the publisher that you're working for, the nature of the job and that kind of thing. Funded and self-funded authorial projects, residency, you know, applying for funding from the Arts Council of Wales or from, you know, all, there's many different funding bodies. If you've got an idea for a project that you need to do, where can, who are the stakeholders, who are the potential stakeholders, who might fund you to do that, and why would they fund you? And being able to convince people that they ought to fund you is an art in itself. And that's something that we're hoping we can, you know, for those of you who think you might be interested in that, we can maybe do some talks about that, particularly Georgina, because she has a lot of experience of that kind of thing. And then exhibitions, you know. Exhibition is something that many illustrators do, selling work through galleries. So that's not obviously not exhaustive, but it does, I'm sure it touches on some of the things that many of you are interested in doing.
What's becoming quite common is the hybrid career, so that you might do combinations of things, half and half for a year, you might do one of those things for a year, you might be doing 3 years and then 3 years or something else, my career's being like that, it's been phases, and most people have multiple careers now. This is my common Facebook in the summer, and which I'm using partly for the talk today, which is about creative habits. That's 1 till 2, the Vertical Studio, so please come to that, because it's talking about the qualities and attributes and habits that you need to develop. Some of it will be reminders of things you might have forgotten, and others will hopefully give you some new insights. But I just made this little mixy book. So, yeah, part dragon, part bird, part a rocket powered underwater illustrator, or you could be a policeman illustrator, or you could be a detective illustrator, being a restaurateur, the barber photographer in Harlesden. His barber during the day, but he also has amazing photography, and all that photography comes out from conversations he has as a barber. There are lots and lots of different ways that you can manoeuvre. Plasticity is the adaptability, but then having these hard skills and hard resources that fuel you through, and hard curiosity, so you know, actually, what I really want to do is this. What I'm really interested in that, what I'm really curious about, then what I find.
Do you remember how many of you came to the talk by Geraint Evans? Geraint Evans, at the Royal Drawing School last year, the news. And you know, he had a whole year of working in a chip shop, I can't remember where it was now, somewhere in the valleys, I think. And you know, during his time in the chip shop, working full time in a chip shop, he'd just been doing loads and loads of drawing in the chip shop when things were quiet. He'd get the greaseproof paper out and he'd draw on that. And it was that, his particular perspective on the world from the job that he was doing there, and the fact that, you know, he was drawing on the chip paper, and that really impressed the people. He then got a place in the Royal Drawing School, which is very prestigious. But it was his ability to kind of make the most of the situation that he was in that gave his work a particular kind of angle, and then was a vehicle for him to progress onwards. And actually, a lot of his work, so that was really pivotal creatively in terms of the work that he's doing next. So many of you are going to be doing part-time jobs. You know, maybe some of you can draw on the job, maybe some of you can't. But it's thinking about actually what does that other job that you're doing, how does that feed into what you're doing as an illustrator? Or how does it provide you other skills that are relevant to what you might be wanting to do next? So it's also thinking about that. Very few people graduate and are able to make a living just from creative work, illustration work, immediately. Usually it does involve doing something else. You know, all of us have done many, many different kinds of jobs in order to support ourselves as we're getting off the ground. And then there are times when you are able to, maybe you build up to a point where you are able to sustain yourself and do that full time, which is wonderful. And other times you might need to balance it with other kinds of work. So being open to that, but also understanding that, you know, like Chris is saying, that kind of hybridity in terms of the work that you're doing is increasingly the way that people do work now.
And if you own a fish shop, if you own a fish shop, you're loaded. Okay. So the other model is that you have a business which brings in income, which allows you to have enough time to do your own authorial creative work. That's that model as well. So famous composer Charles Ives in America was an insurance salesman. Look at lots of the novelists, famous novelists, British novelists of the 20th century, mid-20th century. You look at their biographies, their work as civil servants. Philip Larkin, the poet, was a librarian in Hull. So it's that hybridity. So that could be an employed income, you have an employed income which gives you time, that allows you to shut the door, have a job where you can close the door and have your own space, oasis to do creative work. Or you generate your own, you make your own business. Now, the people in the Centre of Entrepreneurship here could really help you with that.
And if any of you aren't freelance illustrators, that means you have your own business. You're setting up your own business. You're registering self-employed. So understanding what's required in terms of being self-employed is part of what you need to know. And that's one of the things that Dan Hinkson's going to be working with hopefully, with this. It's not Dan Peterson, it's going to be someone else, but it's likely to be Dan Peterson, and that will be next term. And that will be part of your professional practice actual project. So what you've got this year is throughout your exposure module and throughout your subject module, so from now on through to the summer, you've got this series of different kinds of sessions that can help you. We're going to start quite general. So the sessions that Chris is going to be doing with you are really, it's before you even begin to kind of go out and you know, think about sending your work to people, you need to have a sense of what your work is about. And so one of the things Chris is going to be developing with you is that ability to step back and see what it is that you do and how to present it. So it's really important that before we get into the nitty-gritty of professional practice stuff, like setting up, registering the self-employed and how to do your taxes and all that kind of stuff, it's important that, you know, the ground is laid. So we're going to begin with this professional development module. It's not really a module, it's kind of a part of the course, where there's going to be lots of workshops and conversations and opportunities for you to reflect on where you might like to go and how to prepare for that.
So I'll be helping you visualise that using your illustrative skills, so you can make maps and images of your what you've got and where you want to go, and then the ability to talk about that between yourselves, and then we take that into simulated life situations. So we do a workshop where we're rehearsing all the kinds of different conversations that you have, context that you have, whether it's bumping into somebody in a short conversation at a festival, or whether it's actually going to have a meeting with somebody. So we rehearse it, so you get comfortable with doing that and rehearsing those scripts.
And so that sort of spans the whole year, but you've also got this particular brief, and I'm going to go through this brief with you. So this is part of your exposure module, and it's an accessible, it's 20 credits, so it's 20% of your exposure module. So it's a credit-bearing part of your assessment. So I'm just going to read this out. This is a generic brief. Everybody in the school is doing this. Okay, so it's when the programme was revalidated last year, this was a new component that was added. So I'm going to just read this brief to you. Soon you'll be a graduate with a qualification, a portfolio of work and skills to help you on your way through your professional life. Frequently, the difference between success and failure is in the preparation. This assignment aims to prepare you with the knowledge and skills to best facilitate that transition from university to the world of work and practice. It aims to help you form clear and achievable goals underpinned by relevant research and developed into a comprehensive strategy for your progression upon graduation. So underpinned by relevant research, it's really, you know, we are going to help you as much as we can, but it's so crucial that you follow up with your own research, because then it becomes specific to you. You know, we can talk generally about stuff, but you know specifically what you are interested in and what you need to research. So important that you just begin the process of doing that, just in a casual way. I know you've got a lot of other work that you're doing at the moment, but, you know, spending just those little bits of time throughout the week to just start to investigate. For this assignment, you'll have to produce a PowerPoint presentation
which will constitute 20% of your summative assessment mark for your exposure module. This PowerPoint will be no longer than 15 slides and take the form of a graduate action plan, i.e. what you intend to do with your education to inform the next stage of your life. Your graduate action plan should illustrate the steps you've already taken and the steps you will need to take to make your plan a reality. This assignment focuses on how you source and act on professional opportunities and how you should present yourself within a professional context. The initial period of research will involve investigating what opportunities exist to you as a graduate. Consider all options, be exhausted in your search, think about regional, national and international opportunities and markets. You must choose at least one opportunity as a live application, and it must be appropriate for your intended career path. This application, along with its response, must be evidenced in your PowerPoint. So even though the deliverable is 15 slides, that is the tip of the iceberg, because you know underpinning that is going to be all of the kind of research that you're going to be doing throughout the year, supported by the sessions that we're doing, but only supported by the sessions. So the onus is on you to do this search, being exhausted in your search and finding out what opportunities are available to you. And if you need help with that, you know, come talk to us in personal tutorials if you need more kind of specific guidance, and talk to S as well. S is really helpful. S is very aware of creative opportunities for graduates. That's her job, so she can help you with that as well.
So how many of you spoke to S? She does drop in. I think they're only Thursday.
I think she's coming into the Vertical Studio meeting today as well. You don't need to worry about the specifics of this yet, because you're going to be doing this, handed in the summer. But just to give you a heads up, your presentation should incorporate your CV, a digital portfolio of your work, and examples of professional web presence. As the PowerPoint is an action plan, it should also include research regarding funding bodies, regulations, institutional details which may form part of your action plan. So for example, if you decide, you know, you want to go on and do an MA and you're not really sure what you want to do yet, or, you know, that's fine, but don't be vague about that. Even if it's about postgraduate study, it's important that you've done your research, you know what MAs are out there, you know what their specific offer is, you know what the process of application is, you know you've investigated how to get funding for postgraduate study, same if you wanted to do a PGCE. So, or whether it's freelance work, you've done that kind of investigation. So the deliverables is a PowerPoint of no more than 15 slides containing identified professional opportunities, a CV, a live application, and also your CSAD online catalogue submission. You're going to be working on your catalogue with Georgina, and examples of work presence. So this is your date of submission, May 11th, and that's for your overall exposure level. So it's not that far off. So it's important that you do get people well into that. These are the learning outcomes and assessment criteria. So, you know, it's helpful just to think about what's the purpose of this. To demonstrate a clear understanding of where your practice sits within a professional context and how professional level opportunities can be accessed. Demonstrate an ability to anticipate and accommodate change and work within the context of ambiguity, uncertainty, and familiarity. Illustration is changing constantly. You know, the context for your work might be completely different in 5 years' time. So it is, you know, that's why your sense of your more general creative skills, in addition to the specifics of the work that you do, are really important for you to value, because you're going to be bringing all of those to the changing scenario and being adaptable. Demonstrating and the assessment criteria, so this relates to this. So if you go, just going back into Moodle, so if you just want to have I'm going to try and populate this with a bit more stuff, but there are some suggestions of reading. If you are interested in freelance illustration, I know it's a cheesy title, but actually this is quite a good book, How to Be an Illustrator. It's written by Daryl Weiss and Nicholas Bleckman. Nicholas Bleckman is an art director at the New York Times. and Daryl Leach runs part of the Ocean Agency that I used to work with. And it's got lots of interviews with different with illustrators and art directors and commissioners and different types of commissioner. And it's quite a good just kind of glimpse in to kind of get a sense of some things that are important to consider. You know, it's not the be-all and end-all, but it's a good way in, and there's quite a lot of copies in the library, I think. There's also other things like the Association of Illustrators. Are all of you familiar with the Association of Illustrators? It's the main professional body for illustrators in the UK. So have a look at their website, and they've got lots of directories, and these are also available in the library. These are client directories, and they've got things like guides to law and business for illustrators. If you join, you know, I think the membership fee is something like £100 a year, I think it's much cheaper for students. And then you can go to them for advice. If you've got, you know, a job and you're finding it difficult to price the job, you can go to them for advice or legal advice or advice about writing contracts with an agency. Dan Beekston's going to cover a lot of that stuff with you, but just to, so that you know that that resource is there. But also on here, I just put some... I put some reflection points. So, you know, have a look at this. I'm sorry it's not very visually interesting. You know, it's did a lot of work on Moodle over the summer. It's incredibly time consuming. And I would love to put lots more pictures and videos and things on, and I'll try and do that when I get time. But at the moment, it's just text. But, you know, have a look at it, because just thinking about some of these things, thinking about these reflection points, and actually writing about them too, not just thinking about them in your head, but putting them on your blog. So one of the things I want to just mention today, that we touched on, was about your learning journal and the role of that in your assessment this year as well. So is that clear to you, just to, in terms of the shape of the year, what you're aiming for in terms of specifics and all of the stuff that's going to kind of feed into that? Are there any questions about that?
Really good poem here, if I crash. Listen while you speak. Don't say you're right too often, teacher. Let the students realise it. Don't push the truth, it's not good for it. Listen while you speak. So, what do you need to know? What would be most helpful for you in this area of the course, this module? Have a quick conversation with each other, and let's generate some of your questions so that we know what your concerns are and what your interests are.
What's the question again?
Thank you. What would be most helpful? What do you need from this module? What would be helpful?
What do you
need?
I need
to
come to
that would be most helpful. Not being hungry.
Yeah. I'm just sat here, just like, I wish I had like shades on, to like just fall asleep. I just like zone out, I'm just like, oh, just like, oh.
That's why I record it.
It's much too much shorter.
I'm kind of looking forward to being easy, I'm going to be honest. I'm looking forward to not having to like stress about stuff. To just be in a normal job and then be able to do what I want on the side. I'd much prefer that myself to constantly worrying about assignments and deadlines, shit like that.
Just a job that you can like switch your brain off, go in and do that.
Come home with my free time and be like, what do I want to do? This degree makes me feel like I don't ever have free time, so I feel like I'm always on my own. Should obviously work.
So, quick follow up with questions and headlines.
Probably things to do with money, like tax, what to charge, how to do avoidance.
Thank you. So hand up those of you who talk about money. So money, that's a concern for how I make a living, how most need not. Okay, so I will talk a bit about multiple streams of income, how that works. So you can be making work, you can be doing things for commission, you can have work out there for sale. What, which is also already generating an income. What else?
Well, I was just thinking, speaking to people already in the field.
Yeah.
Because I have a range of different sources.
Yeah, and by email, I just probably go to talk to someone about like what options there actually are, because I know there's multiple options, but maybe knowing what there is might help me know where I want to go.
If you want to know the road ahead,
yeah.
Ask those coming back.
Yes.
Really good for you to hear people who graduated 5 years ago and are already making their way. That's really good. Every time we've had people like that come in, you do absolutely all ears, because it's like that for me is real. I'm not going to. I'm longer road with me, but you can ask me. But there are lots of people you can talk to. People whose job it is to advise you, I guess. And then we have guest speakers, and then we have people that you've worked with already in live projects last year. Lots of people who also, think of the people who know people. So I'm just thinking back to Circle Line last year, John Hardy, head of composition at the Royal Welsh College of Music. His contacts would be enormous, and he knows loads of practitioners. So if you want to collaborate with musicians, that's a good person to know. Or talk to any of the people he knows, and they get to talk to him. So that's often how it works. So how many photographers do you actually know? So, if you want to meet work, you know a couple of photographers, go to the David Hearn exhibition, which has just opened at the National Museum of Wales. In his career, he met many other photographers, and he did swap. He said, I'll give you one of my photographs. And so there's an exhibition. He's given the collection, 1,500 photographs, to the museum.
Yeah, that's cool.
Okay, and so those people are in the room. And then, so there was an opening last week, and he was there. And lots of those other photographers were there. It's a very well-known photographer there. So get on the mailing lists, accept invitations, and go to opening, and be ready to just say, introduce yourself. I'm Chris. That's what we're doing. The invitation that we've been offered, or with some information. So being ready in those situations. So those are the kinds of places to go. Do go to openings of shows this year. They tend to be on Thursday.
Yeah. Any other thoughts about what it would be helpful to know about? And this is, you know, this is good for you to hear, because you can start investigating it for yourself, but you can also, you know, it's good for us to know so that we can maybe help to give you some suggestions as well.
Maybe how much experience you need from like for a job? It's like going into it and let's go on, maybe just not even.
You mean for a freelance job?
Yeah, or anything.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I was thinking more like, I know all the options are there, and we're going to research them throughout the year, but how will I know what's right for me? How will each of us know what's right for each of us? Is there like specific careers advice? Is there...
Yes, but that is one of the main purposes of the sessions that Chris is going to do with you, is to help you identify that.
How do I know? How do I tell? How do I? It's guts, mostly. It's reading the symptoms and what they are. Information, places for this advice, like the AOI website, so you go down and people go, you know, it's codified information. But there's also relational information where you meet a real person who's had a real career and they'll tell you their version. And none of the advice you get will be from individuals, will be the right advice. It's just you should take what you want. So I would say the more people you speak to openly, the more you'll be able to.
And talk in personal tutorials as well, that's an opportunity to really talk it through in depth with a one-to-one basis as well.
You've got an immediate audience of 150 illustration students. So vertical studio is important. Who do you sit next to in the vertical studio? They're chatting with other year groups, because these are people who will be part of your audience, part of your, they might be dramatically collaborating with you. Huge talent coming through. Big first year coming through, 60 students, grade 5, that's very switched on, resourceful, so get to know the other groups, because as soon as you've graduated, those year groups, they won't mean a thing. By the time you're 26, being 27 or 28, it really doesn't matter. Okay. Good. What else? So money, and how's it going to pan out? How do I know where to get the advice? What else do you need to know that would be helpful? Yeah.
like how to put together a really strong portfolio and be able to talk about it professionally to other professionals.
Okay, that's interesting because one of the that's a good point. So what we're going to have this year, hopefully this term, I think, is Phil Reeves' work, who's an illustrator, who is going to come and help you. He's going to give you quite a serious kind of critique. He's coming in as an outsider. He's going to give you some, I think the idea is he's going to give you some portfolio advice.
He was there last year,
pardon? He was
there last year.
He was here last year, and, you know, people were a bit like, ooh! But, you know, you need that. You need that because if you want that real critical feedback about what to put in your portfolio, what not to put in, how to prepare something that has that's at the standard that you want it to be, you need to have that resilience. You need to be able to hear things that are sometimes difficult to hear. So prepare yourselves for that. If anyone doesn't want to have those kinds of conversations, then you don't have to do. But think about what you're getting from having those conversations.
We're lovely, supportive, warm coaches.
Yeah.
So every way, all the way there, we're all the way. But then it's good to have somebody come and say, well, what's that? Sorry, I don't get that.
Because if you don't have it now, you might have it later on and then it might be more difficult.
But there's a small portfolio into the animation industry. Small portfolio, the big mouth, and I met this editor. I showed my portfolio, they passed it on to him, and then he said, yeah, I'll talk to him, I'll talk to Chris. And he was there talking to me, just flipping through. He looked at my 12 pieces of artwork and he just kept flipping through the empty pages.
Who is this?
I'm not saying. There's not a lot there. I got the job, but and he was right. So sometimes, occasionally, it does help to have to speak to somebody. You don't know. You may only meet once, and not fall over weeping. You know, I heard now, but yes, maybe the night.
And knowing, you know, there's some people who are going to absolutely love your work and want to, you know, hire you the next day, and there's other people who are just going to feel completely the opposite. I've within the space of a week, I think I've shown the same work to two people who have completely opposite responses to it. You know, that's just the way it is. People have different tastes. People have different, you know, for example, if you're working in publishing, every publisher has their own kind of aesthetic, and some people, each art director has their own kind of aesthetic, their own taste, and sometimes your work just doesn't fit with that. It doesn't mean you're not good, it just means it's not right for them. So, you know, one of the things that's important in your freelancing as well, in terms of who you approach, is really understanding who you're approaching and why you're approaching them, why they're right for the work that you're doing, being quite targeted about it. Sometimes it helps to do big mailouts and just kind of cast the net really wide, and other times it's helpful to do your research and really be specific about who you're approaching and know that your work is right for them. These are all the things that we're going to hopefully have opportunities to talk about in more depth as we go along.
You know, you may have a specific kind of like subject matter or way of working,
yeah,
a certain style, but like, the terms that you have to kind of like adjust to, I guess, the market sometimes or what?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's an interesting one. I mean, I think in my experience, you don't really have to adjust.
Completely, okay.
Because I think people hire you because they want what you do.
Yeah.
And I don't think, it's not like I need a plumber who's, you know, like looking in the phone book and finding someone, yeah, and then saying, okay, but I need you to do this, if you do it more like that. No. They will only go to you because of what you do. If they don't like what you do and they want something that's a bit more like that, then they'll go to someone who's a bit more like that. They won't expect you. Do you know what I mean? I mean, I think, I'm sure there's exceptions to that. It depends. If you're working, for example, in a company, then it might be that you need to be more versatile. But if you're working commission, I would say on the whole, you need to be sort of like clear about what you do and adapt to the different context and the different subject matter, and, you know, obviously your work changes depending on that, but I don't think you need to feel that you have to change your way. But maybe some people would argue that, but that's the point. But, you know, what's important is all of these, you know, Chris asked me that question, what do you want to know? It's really important that you go away and think about that. And some of you know you've already spoken
made some really good suggestions. Some of you might want to go away and mull over it. But do bring them back to us. To all of the sessions that you're going to be doing with us. You know, we can unpack, we can have longer discussions about all of these points. We can really look at these things in more depth. But, you know, we want it to be a dialogue. We want it to be a two-way conversation. It's about you. It's about where you want to go with your work. And we're just trying to sort of help you to ask the right questions and do the right kind of investigation that you need to do to get to where you need to be. So keep thinking about that.
Start thinking about who you would invite to the different place. You start populating that list, you'll identify some people you already know who could be supportive and interested in your work. You need a really good support network, and they usually there's loads of people you've known quite a while. You can visit your address book and donations.
Maybe what we could do is put something up, a big piece of paper up on the wall, and then whenever you have an idea about something that you think would be useful, you could just come along and write it, and then we can just keep it up and on with that. Should we do that? Maybe stick it up on that wall or something. Okay. So I'm just going to talk about the Learning Journal a little bit. So your blog has been renamed the Learning Journal this year. Does that make you feel completely differently about what it is?
Yeah.
So you know by now, you know it's an important part of your degree. You know that it's really important in assessment. Some of you maybe learned that the hard way a bit last year. I would say that there was quite a lot of inconsistency in the standard of blogs when I was assessing the work. At the end of the second year, some people had really engaged with it, other people hadn't, and it did affect the grade that you got. And it will affect the grade that you get at the end of the third year as well. That's the main thing that we assess, because that is the school policy. That's the system that we're working in. You have to assess your blog. So, I'm not going to talk about that too much because you kind of know by now what you need to do, what's expected. Any of you do really struggle with reflective writing? It's, John Clarkson now is our bespoke constellation person who's our link tutor. He's going to be there to offer support in reflective writing. So if any of you do feel that you just want a bit more help with that, or you want to talk it through with someone, approach us and we can approach him or approach him directly and see if he's available to meet up with you. I've put, this is on your main, on the main illustration page again, not your year page, the main page. I think the section's called Academic Blogging Guidelines, and it's got like a person's waist with lots of writing in it. I think it's David Herxheimer. And in that section, I've just put this together. So it just gives, down here at the bottom, support. So, technical support, Matt Leafield, writing support, John Clarkson, student, there's dyslexia support available, year tutor or personal tutor for just general kind of guidance on it. But I've put these guidelines together, which might just be helpful for you to think about what kind of level is expected of you. If you can stay on top of it throughout the year, if you can just make it a positive part of your work routine rather than this kind of chore that you have to do at the end of the year, that's really going to help you. And reflective writing, many, many artists use reflective writing as a really important part of their practice. And I think it's something that once you kind of embrace it, it can be really enjoyable. For some of you, the actual act of writing into the blog might not feel that great. You might prefer writing in a journal, handwriting, in a diary, or in a sketchbook, drawing, and writing. You can do that, and you can, as long as it's legible, instead of, typing into your blog, we're very happy for you to scan those pages and upload those to your blog instead. It's still a learning journal if you want to write it by hand, for example. Or you can transcribe it. But, make it something that feels creative for you, would be my advice.
So the suggestion is to make regular reflective posts about your practice between 100 and 200 words, and contain images of your development work and process. Please make sure images are good quality. You had some really dodgy, like mobile phone photos of work on blogs last year. That's not going to get you random points when it comes to assessment. So do make sure, you know, you're an illustrator, value your images. Every image you put out into the world, think about the quality of that image. You should care, as illustrators, you know, we care about images. Images are important to us. We care about the quality of the images that we're putting out there. They don't have to be onerous. 150, 200 words, that's not much, that's a few sentences. But doing it regularly. Regular reflective posts about your practice and regular reflective posts about your research. And that would be your research in terms of all the artists you're looking at, all the other, you know, writers and filmmakers and the stuff that you're reading and the exhibitions you're seeing and all of regular reflective posts on that. Again, just between 100 and 200 words is fine. Also, I would suggest that you do regular reflective posts about the professional practice research that you're doing as well. And then, you know, these regular posts, make them at least every 2 weeks. You know, just putting a little bit up there every couple of weeks will just help it keep ticking over. And then end of project posts are reflective summaries of your learning throughout the project. So this is not so relevant for third years because, you know, some of you are doing long projects, some of you are doing a series of short projects. But even in the third year, I think it's important within your longer projects, we're really encouraging you to have a structure and to set milestones for yourself. Did you all get the thing that the group told you that you needed to look at with your milestones? So perhaps at the end of each milestone, you might want to write one of these slightly longer, reflective summary of your learning throughout that stage of practice, around 300 words, and always again using good quality images or links to the image. And then end of module entry, so this will be really when you hand in at your summative assessment points. And those need to be a bit longer, so that's more like 500 words, and you know, make sure it feels substantial as a kind of effective summary of what you've done. So there you go, that's just hopefully helpful to just give a little bit of a kind of framework of what's expected in terms of your blog. Okay, any questions?
Yeah, I was going to say, I prefer to do my blog in like big posts, so does that matter, or do I have to have these 2 week posts all the time telling small details?
It depends. I mean, I think the purpose of doing these regular ones is that it's supposed to be a journal.
Right.
So it's supposed to be reflecting on your practice as you're going along, rather than a big analysis at the end. You know, it's sort of just, it's almost like a diary in that sense. Not a personal diary, but a work diary. But if you want to, if you're keeping that going, you know, again by writing or something, and you know, every few weeks you're writing something, but you only upload it to your blog sporadically, that's okay. But I would say what's important is keeping that regular reflective routine going, that regular reflective writing. So these are the guidelines that we're giving you.
Yeah.
But you know, it's not set in stone. If you do it that way and it's really, you know, it's really strong, then you know,
yeah,
you're kind of open to that. But I think it's just understanding the purpose of this is, that's why we're calling it a learning journal. Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other thoughts or questions? How many of you kind of actually enjoy the process of reflecting on it? How many of you think it's something you don't really enjoy that you can see the point of it? Okay, and how many of you just think, oh god, it's a whole load of you and do it to keep it? Okay.
You can do it with images and with illustrators and keep that relationship going with images and text. It's very important. The greatest ever thing is the amount of it. So that's my current channel. So scan that, it's just quite alert, it's quite legible, but I'd scan that and then add maybe a couple of notes about that, that page or keywords. And you can combine yours with shorter entries, diary entries, which just the keywords. It's because if you just have an epiphany or an insight, it's good to get it down and think while it's fresh. And then look at it maybe at the end of the week and compile a short sort of summary of that, and at the end of the term, a bit longer. Just so you've got the material. Yeah. Just bank the material as you go.
How many of you have blogs that are sort of for the public? Well, it is, but you know, a lot of illustrators do, rather than having static websites, prefer to have a blog which feels a bit more active and live, but it's different from social media, it's more edited, it's more for a professional purpose, and it's something that you would share with potential employers and commissioners and things like that. So, you know, part of the doing the academic blog is actually also to develop those skills that you might use more to have.
Something you can do as well, what I was actually utilising, is you can showcase your blog alongside your actual professional work on your website.
Great.
That's quite a space, good.
Okay, so that just hopefully gives you just a little bit of a kind of an idea of what's going to be happening with your professional development stuff throughout the year. So just go away and have a mull over it. Maybe I should leave you with some questions to think about and come back and talk to us about. I'll just leave these up and if there's anything that you think would be helpful to reflect on, maybe you could have a think about that and bring it to the next session. So, what's the next session?
Tutor groups have almost been confirmed with the staff meeting this afternoon to finalise those two groups. So that will end up to you.
Okay, good.
So
will the PowerPoint be put onto
you? I can do if you like. Yeah, shall I put it on the other six page? Or actually what I'll do is I'll put it in the professional practice. Some of it.